All right. Good evening, everybody. Great to have you with us tonight at Grace Baptist as we welcome the group here from West Coast Baptist College. It'll be a real treat for us. But before they come, why don't y'all please stand and we'll turn in our hymnals to number 380, How Firm a Foundation, number 380. How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he hath said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? Fear not, I am with thee, oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God, I will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand, and dwell by my righteous omnipotent. When through the deep waters I call thee to go, the rivers of sorrow shall not overflow, for I will be with thee, thy troubles to bless, and sanctify to thee thy deepest distress. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only design thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. On the last, the soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert to his foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. Amen. Thank you. Great singing.
What a blessing to be here tonight. The ushers could go ahead and usher those people in. It'd be wonderful. There's places way up here. Otherwise, we're going to have to put chairs out in the hallway pretty soon. People keep going in the back pews. And you can get up here. These are the $50 seats, and they're free tonight. So it'll be a blessing for you to be up here a little closer. We have West Coast Baptist College, Brother Gary Spaeth. Is that right? And having him here with four guys traveling, faithful men. And that's actually, you came from a church that has a quartet named the Faithful Men, too, I think, quartet. And so, well, we're glad you're here tonight. Before we hand it over to them, we need to have a word of prayer. But I hope you had a wonderful afternoon. We're looking forward to a great evening tonight, both singing and preaching. And so we trust the Lord will work in our hearts. And, boy, we all need to just be real, honest, and humble these days, right? Real, honest, and humble. Let's pray. Father, help us, Lord, to become more what we should be. Father, we love you. That's why we're here tonight. Our hearts are stirred. We do desire to do your will, desire to continue to glorify you, reach people for you. Father, we are so thankful for your goodness to us. We're thankful for West Coast Baptist College and the men traveling all this ways to be with us tonight. We pray that you would continue to put your hand of provision upon each one of these men, but also protection, Father. Keep them safe as they travel. And Lord, I pray that we would hear from you tonight, that our hearts would be encouraged. But when the Word of God is opened, Father, teach us. Help us to understand how we need to live the Christian life. But then, Lord, help us to apply it. And I pray for the invitation, Lord, that you would work in our hearts at that time. Father, there are people that want to be here tonight, but they can't because of different things. And we just pray that you would be with them tonight and encourage their hearts also. This is being pumped into homes, Lord, all over. We just pray that you would touch the people that are listening tonight, and this would be a blessing to them also at home. We pray for your blessing tonight upon this place. Push away anything that would hinder us. We need your liberty tonight here on this in this pulpit. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Why don't you come at this time, men, and sing for us.
Good evening. We're the Faithful Men Trio from West Coast Baptist College. My name is Aaron. I'm from Compton, California, and I'm a senior studying secondary education.
My name is Josiah. I'm from Warner Robins, Georgia, and I'm a sophomore studying missions.
Hi, my name is Alan. I'm a junior from Cerritos, California, and I'm studying evangelism. And on the piano is Michael. He's from Ghana, West Africa, a junior studying music.
Jesus' feet were growing weary as he journeyed on his way. So he rested at a well's side, a comfort in the heat of day. There he waited for a woman, black with sin and bound for hell. When she arrived, he plainly told her, what you need's not in the well. He's still waiting by the well, and he's holding out his hands. If you drink this living water, you won't have to thirst again. He's been waiting by the well side, knowing you'd be passing by. So take advantage of the moment. He's not gone, he's still waiting by the well. Are you tired of being thirsty, even though you've had your fill? Of the water that the well gives, does it leave you longing still? Well, there is good news about the well side. A woman's voice rings loud and clear. She said this man changed her forever, and if you need hope, you can find it here. He's still waiting by the well, and he's holding out his hands. If you drink this living water, you won't have to thirst again. He's been waiting by the well side, knowing you'd be passing by. So take advantage of the moment. He's not gone, he's still waiting by the well. He's not gone, he's still waiting by the well.
Your word, O Lord, is settled now in heaven. It cannot fail, though time will pass away. The flower fades, the grass will surely wither, but we can trust each promise you have made.
Your faithful word, though it's been tried by fire, it's standing sure, preserved through the ages to evermore endure. And we believe
your faithful word.
Our guiding lights, the source of truth and wisdom, it sanctifies and will not go forth void. Lord, every page is perfect, pure, and changeless. The sword of power that hell cannot destroy. Your faithful word, though it's been tried by fire, it's standing sure, preserved through the ages to evermore endure. And we believe your faithful word. We hide it in our hearts forever. It's anchored in our souls, triumphant over every doubt, our confidence and hope. Your faithful word, though it's been tried by fire, it's standing sure, preserved through the ages to evermore endure. And we Lord, we believe your faithful word. We believe your faithful word. Father, the master of time, he holds the world in his hands. He looks from heaven, sees where you are, arranging your life in his plans, preparing you now, unfolding the way to all your tomorrows and whatever you face. He's already in your tomorrow. He's walking one step ahead. Whether it's joy or it's sorrow, he'll do just what he said. He'll never leave you lonely in the land of the great unknown. He's already in your tomorrow. Don't be afraid to keep pressing on. Often we struggle looking ahead, dreading tomorrow it seems.
Embracing the present, forgetting the past, giving up on your dreams.
You're stranded between your faith and your fear, yet no matter the conflict, the future is clear. He's already in your tomorrow. He's walking one step ahead. Whether it's joy or it's sorrow, he'll do just what he said. He'll never leave you lonely in the land of the great unknown. He's already in your tomorrow. Don't be afraid to keep pressing on. He's already in your tomorrow. He's walking one step ahead. Whether it's joy or it's sorrow, he'll do just what he said. He'll never leave you lonely in the land of the great unknown. He's already in your tomorrow. Don't be afraid to keep pressing on. He's already in your tomorrow. Don't be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Don't be afraid.
Keep pressing on.
Blessing. You're going to sing some more for us, right? But we'd like to take up an offering for West Coast Baptist College. If we could get some guys back there, it'd be a blessing. And I know that Brother Gary will say a few more things about West Coast, perhaps before they sing again. But there is a table in the back, and I'm sure he has a lot to say about that. But you know, Bible College is really, I believe, essential for many reasons. I'm speaking as a Bible college student, but also as a Marine. Young men need to get out of the house and get away for a while and be underneath some other people. And so Bible college will help with that. And don't need to promote too much, but help you understand that you need to be out there a little bit and be under people that will tell you what to do, so you have to do it, like make your bed and different things. It needs to happen. And so if you're thinking about Bible college, think about West Coast Baptist College. It'd be good. If you can give tonight, of course, we'll send this to them, and I'm sure that they'll appreciate it. But coming all this way, they have to have some money for gas, and so we want to take care of that. Brother Tom, would you thank the Lord for the offering, please? This afternoon I was helping him, giving him some pointers this afternoon on how to play the piano. And so, actually not really, but I'm amazed at the piano players, because their right hand is doing something completely different than their left hand. And I don't think my brain would do so well on that, brother, but thank you so much. That is such a blessing. I just wanted to encourage you, Grace Baptist, we do have the trade school tomorrow night again, 5 to 7 tomorrow night here at the church. We'll be, I think, in the teen room or down in the garage. Which one, Mike? I'll try the teen room. That'll be good. And again, there's people have signed up already for that. If you want to be part of that, it's between 5 and 7, and they will instruct you and be a help to you. I want to remind you that the guys that are going to go on the camping trip coming up on the 4th and 5th, let me know so I can get a spot for you. If you're going to bring your tent, make sure you bring your fishing pole and your appetite. It'll be a fun time, but also around the fire as we talk about the Lord. So what a wonderful morning. And I think we had the largest attendance today that we've had for a long, long time, over a year. And God is continuing to bless our ministry. We're seeing people make decisions for Christ, and that's what it's all about, to stay the course, and let's get back at it, folks. But what a blessing to have these men here. I hope they'll continue to stir. You want to say something, Brother Gary? Why don't you come on up?
I always feel like I'm doing a commercial right now. We'll be back in just a moment, but for a word from our sponsor, West Coast Baptist College. All right. We are from West Coast Baptist College. The college is in Southern California. We're just a little bit north of Los Angeles. We are a Bible college, and we exist to train laborers for his harvest. The main thing that we do at West Coast is we train people for ministry. We'll train people in pastoral ministry, missions, evangelism. We'll train them in education, train them how to play wonderful music like that. We'll train people in the visual arts as well. And so if you are interested, or you know somebody who might be interested, at the end of the service, we'll be back at the table. Please feel free to ask any one of us about West Coast. One thing that we do offer is what's called a one-year Bible certificate. So if you are interested in attending maybe another school, but maybe you're not sure what you want to do just yet, you can come for 1 year and get a good foundation for your understanding of Scripture and how to defend your faith, so that if you do go to a secular school, you're prepared because you've got your faith grounded in the Word of God. And that's always helpful. We do also offer that program online. So some of you who probably are not at the stage where you could just uproot yourself and move to Lancaster, California, we do also offer online classes. And that's something else to consider. If you're interested in taking some classes with us, we do have some information about that, or we can get some information sent to you about that those types of programs and various things like that. We have some good godly music, and there is so much ungodly stuff on the radio today. It's good to have godly music. And so there are quite a few different CDs. These are CDs that our choir at West Coast Baptist College has recorded. I always love to talk about this one. You can't see it right here, but this is the state capital of California in Sacramento, a place where a lot of ungodly legislation has been passed. Last year, our school choir was it last year or the year before? 2 years. 2 years ago, they were on the state capitol singing praise to the Lord. And, you know, God is more powerful than anyone, and all of them combined many times over. And so just something that if you want to hear music of these men and these women as they're singing, great add to your collection. The current one is He is Worthy. Some of the songs the men will be singing are found on this one right here if you're interested. We also brought a series of devotional books with us. I know sometimes you look for some good devotional material. This one's just simply Daily in a Word. Maybe you don't have a devotional program set up in your life. This would be good because it's just one reading a day. And just simply read it through, and you can follow along. It has a good application for Scripture and kind of help you to go through the Scripture and understand a little bit more. this one here is another interesting one. It's called Revival Today, and it's based upon a devotional where you can have a devotional on the history of revivals in America, and just something very, very unique, looking at what God was doing during those times. And just seeing some application to some scriptures. And we can pray for God to do a revival, a great reviving of our country soon. So that's also a very good, helpful devotional. Pastor Paul Chappell, he's a pastor of Lancaster Baptist Church. And by the way, West Coast Baptist College is a local church college, which means a local church controls the college. The church becomes a place where the students, as they learn in classes, they can put in practice what they've learned right away. And it just works out in a marvelous way to help the students to prepare them for ministry. Pastor Chappell wrote a book called Keep the Faith. We're being challenged by our faith in our country today. And how do we keep our faith? Well, this is a good book just to go through and understand a little bit more of what's happening today and how to keep your faith even as our world turns further and further away from the Lord. And finally, ladies, if you are looking for a good devotional, this is by Gloria Ann Gibbs. She is David Gibbs' wife and just wrote a nice devotional geared towards women and husbands. If you need a nice gift for your wife, this might be something you might want to buy for them as well. We're pleased to be here. It's a thrill for us to come here and really come across this country and see what God is doing in churches across America. And you know what? God is working. He's working in a tremendous way. And that just shows us that we have a great God. And no matter what the government tries to do to hinder us or try to close us down, they're not going to because we have a powerful God. Well, that's the end of my commercial, so back to our regular scheduled programming.
I remember that moment. I can take you to the place where my burdens were lifted and my sins were washed away. But as time passes by, Lord, if ever I fail to remember the price that you paid, remind me of the thorns you wore as a crown, the stripes that you bore, and the blood flowing down, the nails and the weight of my sin. Should a day ever come when I forget what real love costs, remind me of the cross. Amazed by your goodness, and it brings me to my knees. But if life takes its toll, and it's not well with my soul, then Lord, take me back to Calvary. Remind me of the thorns you wore as a crown, the stripes that you bore, and the blood flowing down, the nails and the weight of my sin. Should a day ever come when I forget what real love cost, remind me of the cross. Stripes that you bore, and the blood flowing down, the nails and the weight of my sin. Should a day ever come when I forget what real love costs, remind me of the cross. Shepherd, the solid rock, my my place of rest. The Prince of Peace will fight my battles. All-knowing God, my sin forgets. All that He is all I need. His boundless love is holding me. His strength is perfect when I'm weak. All that He is all I need.
The mighty King became a servant. The great I Am stepped into time. The wounded one became a healer. Now I am His, and He is mine.
All that He is all I need. His boundless love is holding me. His strength is perfect when I'm weak. All that He is all I need. Beyond the scope of understanding, how could this sinner so defiled be made righteous through His suffering? Once a slave, but now His child. All that He is all I need. His boundless love is holding me. His strength is perfect when I'm weak. All that He is all I need. His strength is perfect when I'm weak. All that He is, all that He is, is all I need. He's all I need.
They did not understand why He wouldn't come as they made their way toward the other side. As they left the shore, they faced the storm, and suddenly they feared for their lives.
But upon the sea there someone walked on the water as they listened for His cry. That's when they heard Him call out their names, and tenderly He said, "It is I."
He's the eye of the storm, the center of my calm, the place where I find shelter, the place where I find warmth, the center of my ways, the keeper of my days. When I can feel the sunshine and my ship is tossed and torn, He's the eye of the storm.
They did not understand how the Prince of Peace could find them in the middle of their sea. Joy would overcome their disbelief. Now there are times in life where I face the storm, and I wonder if I ever will survive. That's when I heard Him call out my name, and tenderly He says,
home, the place where I find shelter, the place where I find warmth, the center of my ways, the keeper of my days. When I can feel the sunshine and my ship is tossed and torn, he's the eye of the storm. Do not fear when he is near, take hold of his strong hand. Listen closely to his voice, the great I am. The great I am still is. The heavens and the earth are his. He's a merciful Almighty. Where I find shelter, the place where I find warmth, the center of my ways, the keeper of my days. When I can feel the sunshine and my ship is tossed and torn, he's the eye of the storm. He's the eye of the storm.
If you have your Bibles, please turn to Philippians chapter number 4. Philippians chapter number 4. I know we've gone through some crazy times with COVID, and we don't know what's going to be ahead, but we do know our God's there. And as they just sang, he's the eye of the storm, the calm amidst the raging seas of life. And it's important for us to know that we have a God who cares for us. A God who loves us, and a God who's given us a wonderful opportunity to come before him and present our request to him. And so tonight what I'd like to do is talk about prayer. And I know you know prayer, you know what it is, but it's always good to be reminded of what prayer is. And as the Apostle Paul is writing to the Philippian church, and what's interesting to know is that as the Apostle Paul is writing, he's in prison. And he's writing to encourage the Philippian believers. And so as he's doing so, he's helping them to understand what he's doing, what helps him. And so he's expressing it to them. And so we can hear those same words today. Our God provides us with a wonderful opportunity to come to him in prayer. So in Philippians chapter 4, just want to look at two verses tonight, verses 6 and 7. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Father, how we thank you for your word. And Lord, your word provides us with a guide through this life. And Lord, I pray that as we look at prayer tonight, that you will use me, Lord, to convey a message of hope, a message of comfort, a message, Lord, that will help us all know that we can come to you, Lord, in any situation. And we know, Lord, that you will hear our prayer and you'll answer it. Thank you, Lord, so much for this time, this opportunity. Lord, let it all be for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, there's a lot of things you could say about prayer. We could talk about some of the different parts of prayer. You think about if I'm looking at it from the fact of maybe adoration and confession, I might have thanksgiving and supplication as things that should be included in my prayer. And we could talk about that. We could talk about the great prayers of our Lord as he prayed the night of his arrest and his trials and just before his crucifixion. We could look at some of the prayers of some of the saints of the Old Testament as well. But one thing that's important is that we could know all there is to know about prayer, but if we fail to pray, what good is it? So what my goal here is to give you a greater passion for prayer, a greater passion in your life to realize that I need to pray every day. I need to be in a state of prayer moment by moment. The Apostle Paul says, pray without ceasing. I think that's really, we're living in a way that we're always in prayer to God. When things happen, we don't have to stop and bow down because we're already communicating with God and know that he's there and he can help us. And so I want to just take this verse and just look at what is given to us about prayer, what we learn about prayer from this verse. And hopefully through that, it helps you to see what a wonderful opportunity that God has given to us through prayer. I want to first look at the description of prayer. So what we have is the Apostle Paul starting out with giving us a description of what prayer is. And to do that, he uses four specific words: prayer, supplication, thanksgiving, and request. So let's just look at each one of those words to help us to understand this wonderful thing we have is prayer. The first word is simply the word prayer. And I think from that word, it gives us a sense of the believer's ability to approach an all-powerful, almighty, holy God with whatever need that we have, whatever situation that we're going through, knowing that he can and he will deal with it and help us through those situations. So we have this wonderful opportunity that we can come before him. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, it says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. So we don't have to come to prayer with the idea of, oh, God, I'm sorry to bother you again, but there's something that came up today that I need to talk to you about. No. He gives us the opportunity to come boldly before the throne. God wants to hear us. Just like your earthly father or your earthly mother wanted to know if there was something that you needed. If you were hungry, they wanted to try to provide for that. How much more our Heavenly Father wants to know what we're going through, and he wants to be with us and help us with that situation. And so we have this wonderful word, prayer, which helps us to understand that we have access to God. If I were to go to the governor of California, I don't know if I'd really want to speak with him, but if I had to, you know, we don't know who's going to be the next governor, and it's just a mess there. So pray for us, all right? But, you know, if I wanted to speak to a governor, or if I want to speak to a president, I would probably have to make an appointment, and it probably would be several months, if not several years, if at all, I would be able to talk to one of those gentlemen. But you know what? The God of the universe, the creator, allows me to have access, free access and direct access anytime I want. What a privilege we have as prayer. And so I think it's important for us to know that God has given us this privilege. We should take full advantage of what he has given to us. It's to our advantage to pray to God. And so through this first word the Apostle Paul gives to us is the fact that we can come to the Lord in our prayer. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12 says, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. God is there waiting for us to pray to him. Now, I don't quite understand, I can't quite grasp just how awesome God is, but let's say there's like 7 billion people on this earth, and let's say that a third of them were Christians, and the third of them wanted to pray to God at the same time, he could hear every single one of those prayers, and he could act at the same time to make sure that everything is taken care of based upon their prayers and based upon his will. God is an awesome God. And so let us never approach prayer from the standpoint, oh, God, I don't want to bother you. His ears are open unto our prayers, and he wants to hear from us as well. Why not make most use of it? The second word we have, so we have the word prayer. The second word is the word supplication. The idea of supplication is emphasizing the fact that when we come to God in prayer, we can make a request. We can ask God for something. We can ask God to change something. We can ask God to help us in some different ways. When we pray, we're requesting God to act or intervene in a need or situation that has arisen in our life or somebody else's life. I know that when I heard a couple months ago that my mother was diagnosed with breast cancer, that caused me to pray a lot more for my mother, realizing that I couldn't do anything to help my mother. She couldn't really do anything. The doctors, they think they can, but it's really in God. He is the true healer. And so in that situation, I made a request before God that he would heal my mother. And I was up to visit her. She lives in Buffalo, New York. I was up to visit her a few weeks back and heard from the doctors. And they said, she is doing remarkably well. They were astounded at how well she was doing. She's 85 years old. Oh, shh, don't tell her I told you that, okay? She's 85 years old, but she's doing remarkably well having chemotherapy. It's just God. It's just God doing that. And we can make our request before God, no matter how big or how small our request might be. We can make it and know that God can intervene. He can do something. Now, we understand that God sometimes has something different in mind. And we also have to accept that. We have to pray in faith believing, but we also have to pray according to the will of God. And so if I pray, Lord, heal my mother, and God has something else he wants to do, I've got to accept that as well. Because I know that God is a good God. And he is always good, and no matter what he does, it's always good. It may be hard because my human perspective doesn't see everything that God can see and what is the best situation. I need to recognize that I still need to pray. I still need to bring my request before God. You know, when a situation like you hear the word cancer comes up, it's very easy at that time to know I need to pray about it. But just as urgent is it for us to pray every single day for God to guide us. While we're driving around the van, I don't know how many thousands of miles we put on the van in just a few weeks. I know we just had the oil change. So that tells me it's at least 3,000 miles. We pray and ask God to guide us. Because you know what? It's not my driving, okay? But it's God that guides us. And so I can't take credit for us being here tonight. You can thank God for doing that because we ask him to help and guide us. And we've gone through some rain and you know, some difficult driving, but the Lord has seen us through. And praise the Lord for that. And sometimes when we just back out of our driveway, Lord, help me, guide me. When we're waking up in the morning, Lord, this is your day. Lord, I want this day to be for your glory. Show me what I can do. And those are some important prayers. And that's the idea of asking God for things that we need. Psalm 31, verse 22. For I said in my haste, I am cut off from before thine eyes. Nevertheless, thou heardest the voice of my supplication when I cried unto thee. Psalm 34, verse 4. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from my fears. If you ever want to see the power of prayer, just read through the book of Psalms and see how David went through some difficult situations. And he prayed to God, and God heard his prayer, and God answered, and God delivered him from all the difficult situations that he found himself in. And the same God that delivered David is the same God that delivers us. And we can look at David and say, oh, well, David was a man after God's own heart. He walked with God. And God's going to hear David's prayer, but I don't know if he's going to hear my prayer. He'll hear your prayer. David is just like us. We're just like David. You know, we can walk with the Lord as David walked, and we can pray to God in whatever situation and know that God will help us. It's not just for the super saints, but it's for everybody that God has given us. And that's why that's why Paul here tells those in the Philippian church, be careful for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Be worried about nothing. But in all things, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And how is it important that this is written for us today? And so, once again, when we know what God has given us, why not take full advantage of what he has given to us as well? The third word, so prayer, supplication, with thanksgiving. Now, a lot of times we don't think about thanksgiving as a part of prayer, but thanksgiving is a major part of our prayer because we need to thank God for all the wonderful things he's done for us. I remember as a child, my mother tried to instill in me that I needed to be thankful. If somebody did something for me, I need to turn around and thank them. One illustration I always think of is when I was little, my mother went to the grocery store. The cashier would always pull out the drawer that had a full packet of suckers in it, and she'd pull one out and she'd hand one to me, and my mother would stop me before I took it, said, "Well, what do you say before you take it?" And my response should have been, "Thank you." And just the same way is that when we pray to God, we need to make sure we thank him. And I think thanking him for the prayer that he's about to answer. Because if we thank him before he answers the prayer, we're praying in faith. We're praying in faith, believing that God will do something with our request. And so I think it's important for us to thank him even before we receive the answer. I think it's important to thank him after we see him receive the answer for our prayer. God doesn't need to answer our prayers, but he loves us, and he does. And I think it's important that we show our gratitude to him. Ian Bounds said, "Thanksgiving is but an expression of an inward conscious gratitude to God for mercies received." And so it's so important for us to make sure that we are a thankful person when it comes to prayer. Psalm 136, verse 1, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endureth forever." Praise the Lord for that. You think about Daniel. Daniel was a man of God. He was a man of prayer, but he also knew that it was important for him to thank God. And so as he prays in chapter 2, and God gives him the answer to his prayer, he first of all says, "I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, and has made known unto me what we desired of thee, for thou hast made known unto us the king's matter." And so as he's praying, he's thanking God for what he's done. It's important for us to be thankful people. Prayer and thanksgiving, they're inseparable because we recognize that God is doing some wonderful things, but it's by his grace, it's by his mercy. It's not because of my merit, not because of anything I've done, but solely because of what God has done that makes the difference. Prayer, supplication, thanksgiving, and the last word that he uses is the word requests. And when I see that word, I'm always reminded of the fact that when we pray to God, it's important for us to pray very, very specifically. You could look out at the mission board out in your hallway and you could walk by and say, "Lord, bless all the missionaries." And I believe God hears that prayer, and I believe he does answer that prayer. But I think a better way of doing it is to pray individually for missionaries, pray individually for the needs of those missionaries. Be very, very specific. I think sometimes we might not pray specific because we're afraid that if we pray too specific that God may not answer our prayer, or we may look foolish if we pray and we don't get the answer. But pray in faith, believing. Pray that God will do something. And you know what? God works. God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. So as much as you can kind of fathom what God could do, he can do 10,000 times 10,000 times 10,000 times more than what you could ever imagine. And so we have to recognize that our God is an awesome, great, loving, merciful God. And there's nothing too difficult for him at all. So we can make some very, very specific requests to God. And I think it's important that we do make specific requests, because I'm reminded of the vice president of West Coast Baptist College, Dr. Getch. He travels around and speaks quite a bit, and he just drives typically where he goes. And I remember he was saying that he was driving from one church to another church, and he was getting a little sleepy on the road. And I can identify him. Coming here this afternoon, we had a nice lunch, and all I could think about is, boy, wouldn't it be nice just to take a nap when I'm driving? No, I don't need to do that. So I had to stop and get some coffee, and yeah, that jolted me up. So I'll be awake all night probably, but I'm awake. But he said that, you know, he's getting really sleepy, and he prayed, Lord, keep me awake to get to this church, get to this meeting. And the Lord answered his prayer, but maybe not in the way he wanted it answered. Because Dr. Getch says that after he prayed, his tooth began to bother him. And he had this tremendous pain in his mouth with his tooth. He stayed awake. The prayer was answered, but maybe not the specific way. So if you pray to stay awake or something, pray, you know, Lord, please don't give me a toothache. Please don't give me any pain to stay awake. Just simply keep me awake. That might help out a little bit better. But, you know, I think it just underlines the fact that we can pray very specifically for one another. And we are to pray for one another. And if you don't know how to specifically pray for somebody, just ask them. How can I pray for you? You know, what a wonderful phrase that we can say to somebody. How can I pray for you today? You know, maybe it's your spouse. Have you recently gone to your spouse and said, how can I pray for you today? What about your children? What about your parents? Taking some time to really pray specifically for their needs, finding out what their needs are, and knowing that God will intervene in those situations. Don't just simply pray, Lord, heal this person. Lord, help this person as they're going through surgery. Lord, guide the doctor's hands. Lord, be with the anesthesiologist. Make sure that they do their job correctly. Just very specifically, walk through the situation and pray for that person as much as you know. Prayer is asking for a gift from God to be received by us. And it's important that we do take the time to pray. And it's important that we look at this. And as you look at these words, prayer, supplication, thanksgiving, and requests, there's a common link between all of those items. And that link is that by praying to God, I'm showing that I can't do it myself. I'm showing God and myself, I need his help. I'm dependent upon God. And you know what? That's exactly how God wants us to be. If you remember the Apostle Paul, he had the thorn in the flesh. He asked God to take it away, and you know, God did not take it away. But he wanted the Apostle Paul to understand that God's strength is made perfect through weakness. And so the more that I realize I can't do this, I can't make it through life without God. I am dependent upon God. I'm dependent on him to make simple decisions. I'm dependent upon him when I'm faced with a problem or difficulty that I'm going to go right to him, and I'm going to ask him to help me through that situation. And so we show that dependence upon God. You know, and it's a position of, you might want to say, humility. I'm saying, you know, God, I can't do anything. And remember, God opposes the proud, but what does he do? Gives grace to the humble. And so prayer is a way that we show our humility before God. And that is simply saying, you know, God, you are able. I am not able. I need your help through this. And so I think the essence of prayer is really to demonstrate a total and complete dependence upon God and knowing that he is able to help. Now, as we look back at that verse, we see this understanding of prayer, that prayer is our ability to come before God. We can make requests before God. We can ask him. And really, think about prayer is asking for God to do something. Pray in faith, thanking God for his responses. We can pray very specifically. But notice what the Apostle Paul says in verse 6. He says, be careful for nothing. Okay? And that idea is be careful, be worried. Don't be afraid about anything. Only God can make that promise. And you know, this is a promise that we have from God, that we don't have to worry about whatever the situation is. We don't have to be worried about anything because we know our Heavenly Father is watching over us. I think one of the hardest things for me to grow up is to realize that my Father wasn't there to take care of the messes that I had to make. I had to take care of myself. You know, if we needed money to pay for a bill, I couldn't just simply go to my dad and say, Dad, can I have some money? I had to do it myself. And that's the idea, is when we recognize the fact that we don't have to be worried about anything, not because our earthly fathers are there, but our Heavenly Father who is there for us. And we can show our dependence upon him, and that's exactly the position that we need to be. But notice how it continues. It says, be careful for nothing, but in, and what's the next word? Everything. Everything. Does that leave anything out? Be careful for nothing, but in everything. Only God could make those absolute statements because God is able to do things absolutely. So, in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Is there a prayer that's too simple to bring to God? I don't believe so. I think this is what this verse is saying. In everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Sometimes we just try to pray about the big things, but pray about the small things as well. The circumstances for prayer is that we need to pray for the minor issues, but we also need to pray for the major issues and know that God is able to work through those and he is able to help us through with those situations. And sometimes there are some things that may cause us to not pray as often as we do. Sometimes there is pride because I'm trying to think, okay, I can handle this one myself. God, I've got this one. You can do somebody else's, answer somebody else's prayer, but no, that's not how it is. We don't want our pride to get in the way of allowing God to work through us in a great way or to guide us. Sometimes there's impatience. You know, God, I want this right now. You know, no, it's in his own perfect timing that we wait. And so sometimes there's our own inadequacies or our own failures that may cause it to happen or cause us to stay away from praying or not really wanting to pray. Sometimes it's fear. Sometimes we're afraid of the answer, but we have to remember God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. And so whatever I pray for, whatever his answer is, I know it's a good answer. Humanly speaking, it may be difficult to go through. You might have to go through some trials. You might have to go through some troubles, but if I know that God is leading me through this, I can rest assured that God has a plan. He's got a perfect plan to get through this, and I will get through this in the way that he wants me to get through it. So finally, the result of prayer. What happens when we pray? So prayer, supplication, thanksgiving, requests, those are the descriptions of prayer that we have. So when I pray, I shouldn't be careful for anything. I shouldn't be worried. I shouldn't be distraught about anything, because I can take those to God in prayer. Look at verse 7. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ. Christ Jesus. Isn't that what everybody's looking for, is peace? The peace of God is what we need. And so as I pray to God, you know what? I can just kind of sit back and say, God's working on this. I don't have to worry about it. You know, God's in control. I gave this to God, and he'll handle this. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, you pray just once and, okay, I'm done with this. No, we need to continually be praying and asking God for help and helping us in our mind to say, God, this is yours. Take care of this situation. But it's the wonderful, marvelous peace of God that passes all understanding. You know, you can be in the midst of the deepest, darkest situation that you might be going through, but you can have perfect peace because of God, and he'll help you through that. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. That word keep is kind of an interesting word. It's a word that's used a lot of times for the military. And so during that first century, you had the Roman soldiers. And so they would have to keep something, or they would have to guard something. Now, a Roman soldier, if they did not keep something, if they did not guard something, you know, they're gone. You know, their life is over. And so it was of utmost importance for them to keep something and guard something. But how much greater our Heavenly Father will keep. And notice what it says. Will keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Well, I think our heart deals with our emotions. And sometimes those emotions run wild, don't they? When we have a situation, what am I going to do? What about this? How is this going to happen? So the fear, maybe sometimes it's the anger. Sometimes it's confusion. All these different emotions that may run through our mind. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall guard your heart, so that your emotions will not cause you to stumble through this time. Your hearts and your minds. Sometimes our minds look at, sometimes take a situation and look at it from the worst standpoint. You know, what's the worst thing could happen? And we, you know, have all these fears come up because, oh, what about this? And what about this? What about this? But as we pray to God, his peace, the peace of God, passes all understanding, shall keep our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus. And that idea of Christ Jesus is because we're saved, because we are born again, because Christ died on the cross, provided me with salvation, that I no longer have to pay for my sins. Christ paid it all. And not only that, it's not just simply that God took care of me so I don't have to go to hell, but God wants to give me a wonderful existence. Jesus said in John chapter 14, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. And so we're waiting for God to come back. And you know what? He's been gone almost 2,000 years. That must be some place that he's making for us, all right? I can't wait to get to it. I don't want to get to it any sooner than I need to, but, you know, it's the idea that we can pray and know that this peace of God can keep our hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. God is on our side because our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior. And it's so important that we recognize that this is something that an unbeliever cannot have this assurance. They can't have the peace that passes all understanding. It takes a person who has Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And I think it's important for us to know that as we look at this, what a wonderful hope we have, but it's conditioned on the fact that, does Jesus Christ have you? Have you been washed by the blood of Jesus? Have you placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ that he indeed is your Savior? If you have, this promise is for you. You have this ability to go to God in prayer, knowing that you'll have that peace of God that passes all understanding, and it will keep your hearts and your minds through Christ, because Christ has paid for our sins and he has given us reconciliation, that we have a new relationship, a restored relationship back to God. And so I just want to condition this on that, because if there's anyone here tonight that doesn't know Jesus as your Savior, I'm sorry, but what I just said doesn't apply to you. But it can, and it can tonight, because you can accept him as your Savior as well. So let's bow our heads and pray. And Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful gift of prayer. Lord, I don't think we can even fathom just how great a gift that you've given to us through prayer. Lord, I do ask that you'd be with each person tonight. Lord, I don't know their needs. I don't know the situations they're going through. But Lord, I know there's a lot of heartache. There's a lot of hurt. Lord, there's a lot of uncertainty with those that are here tonight. Lord, I pray for them. And Lord, I wish I could pray specifically for each one of their needs. But Lord, you know them. And I do ask that you would intervene in these situations. Help your people, Lord, to understand the gift that you've given us of prayer. And Lord, I do pray that if there's anyone here tonight that has never accepted the wonderful gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, Lord, that you would speak to them tonight and help them to realize that this great opportunity of prayer can be theirs as well. They just have to be washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, thank you for being so good. Thank you for your wonderful Savior, Jesus Christ, who laid down his life that we might have life and that we might have it abundantly. Lord, we thank you for all this. In Jesus' name I pray.
Every head bowed, every eye closed. Carolyn, if you want to come. Where's Carolyn? Play the piano, if you would, for us, for the invitation. I think we need to give one. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, just for a moment, and maybe you are full of worry tonight and concern. Maybe there's those burdens that you've been carrying all of these years. They're still there, and you haven't given them to God. You haven't really opened your mouth and said, Lord, I need you. And tonight is an opportunity to come forward and just kneel down at an old-fashioned altar and say, Lord, here I am. And talk to him. He will listen to you. Certainly, if God is in complete control, he knows your heart. He knows your burdens. Sometimes he's just waiting for you to say, Father, I need you to help me. And he's there. If you need to come tonight, I want you to come. Maybe you're here and you still have not put your faith and your trust in Jesus alone. You've put it maybe in a religion, or in maybe it's your baptism as a baby, or you put your faith in something that you've done, but never put it fully in Jesus Christ. Well, tonight would be the night that you could do that. We want you to come. And if you need some help, we'll be up here. But if you just want to come to an old-fashioned altar, why don't you come? Every head bowed and every eye closed. Would you please stand? No one looking around tonight. Let's do business with God. If you need to come, you come. I'm going to pray, and as soon as I'm done, she's going to play the piano. Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit would guide and direct in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. I love church. I love Sundays. What a blessing all of these years. But what a blessing to have these men here. I wonder if they have one more song that they could do. Is it possible to do one more? Could you come back and do one? Is that possible? All right. You can go ahead and be seated if you would. And after they're done, we'll stand. We'll have a word of prayer and we'll be dismissed.
Could the God of heaven love a helpless soul like mine? Why would the great I am send his only son to die? The price he paid for my sin was much too high a cost. But Jesus came and found me and loved me to the cross. He came to me. Now my blinded eyes can see. He forgave and set this sinner free. He died and he rose, and that's all I need to know. When my sin was all I could see, he came to me. Why would he choose to come down, leaving heaven's throne? The earth and all within it could have made his glory known. Yet he saw this worthless sinner and redeemed me through his love. I don't have to know the answer, for I'm covered by the blood. He came to me. Now my blinded eyes can see. He forgave and set this prisoner free. He died and he rose, and that's all I need to know. When my sin was all I could see, he came to me.
I was lost, but now I'm found. Since the Savior came down
and changed my everything.
What a joy I've been given. It's a new life I'm living
as a child of the King. He came to me. Now my blinded eyes can see. He forgave and set this prisoner free. He died and he rose, and that's all I need to know. When my sin was all I could see, he forgave and set this prisoner free. Jesus came down and found me. He came to me.
All right, sounds good. Well, hi, my full name is Aaron Gallardo. I am from Compton, California. If you don't know where that's at, it's basically ghetto LA. both ghetto and liberal. Well, great. Pardon? No, I did not. No, so I lived in Compton, but I was not raised there. I was raised in church. Raised in church for all my life. I am not a preacher's kid or missionary's kid. I am simply just a deacon's kid, really. Just someone who's been blessed to have parents who have faithfully been going to church all my life. And how I really heard about West Coast? Well, California is California. I was able to really visit West Coast, see the heart, see the mission there. And I was able to visit other Bible colleges. However, being at West Coast, it was just different. And to me personally, it wasn't honestly preaching. It wasn't the the professors, it wasn't the classes, it was the students there, the student itself. I think of one or two names that are top of my head where they really invested in me. Students, college students, 18-year-old, 19-year-old, taking their time in a little 15, 14-year-old boy, just like, I'm with, like here once a year. However, you take time to actually talk to me. That's what impacted me. That's what changed my world. So that's why I'm at West Coast, is simply because, hey, someone took time to like, hey, I want to know you by name, and I will take care of you.
So my name is Josiah Feast. I grew up as a pastor's kid in California, and about 5 years ago, we moved to Georgia, all the way across the continent. Grew up knowing about West Coast, and a lot of people thought I would just end up going there, and I did not want to just be what everybody thought. So I, junior year in high school, I went around the nation with my family and looked at a bunch of different colleges. And when we went to West Coast, it's just the spirit there of the staff and everybody. I knew it's where God wanted me. So that's why I'm here today.
Well, my name is Alan Kerygma. I originally grew up in California, but I lived in the Philippines for most of my life. So I lived in the province of Cavite. So I grew up and went to high school over there. And then I came back to America, and I had plans to join the military. So I enlisted in the Air Force, I took the test, and I took my medical. And I was on my way to the Air Force, but the Lord had other plans. And you know, if we take a step out in faith and we trust in the Lord, He'll provide for every single one of our needs. And that's what the Lord has done for me. I'm currently a junior, and I don't know how I'm still here, but you know, the Lord has brought me to it, and He's bringing me through it. So God is good for that.
Hello, my name is Michael Kearney, and I grew up in Ghana, West Africa. That is where my family are missionaries, and in 2018, I came out to West Coast. So, yes.
And this is one of the professors in my master's class. He had Old Testament survey, and I hope I did okay. I don't know. Sometimes I don't know how to do the computer thing, and I'll go into the Canvas. Is that what it's at? And then I try to log out, you know, or whatever, and who knows what I'm doing right or what I'm doing wrong. But online, I get to see a lot of the professors and get to know them a little bit from a distance and to have them come. I think we sat down is Terry Rogers here still tonight. He was here earlier. I think Brother Terry and I sat with your wife and you, I think, a couple years back at the conference there. The conference this year is in October. You're going to all be back there this October, so I'll be able to see you again. But personally, thank you for your desire to do God's will. And you could do a lot of things, fellas, but you're in the eternal work. And that investment you talked about, now you got to continue to pay back and keep bringing the other students in and encourage them also. But what a blessing to have you here tonight. Let's all stand. We'll have a word of prayer. Father, we're so thankful that you've brought us here together tonight. We're thankful for your love for us. And Father, we are in great need of soldiers because we know we're in a war. There's the battle rages, Father. But this war is not with weapons of destruction. It's not with our guns or whatever. It is spiritual war. Lord, as we know that we can be effective eternally with love. And so, Father, we pray that you'd help us all, that we're able to hear the message tonight, both here at the church and also at home, and help us to be ready to be the person that not only prays, but also puts it to practice, Father. And help us to be good soldiers of Jesus Christ. Thank you for this one that decided that he was not going to go to the military, but he was going to join your army, Father. And I pray that you would strengthen him. But Lord, give us more young people that have a heart for you. Lord, lead them away from all of the Hollywood desires or the popular desires or the money. Father, help them to have a heart for you. And we pray for our own church, Father, that you'd be with our teenagers and continue to be with Brother Alfredo Olivares as he teaches them on Wednesday nights, Lord, that they would begin to have a heart for you and go on to Bible college, Father, and be the next generation of people that uphold the truth. We pray that you'd be with Grace Baptist Church, Father. Be with our leadership. Help us to stay the course, but stay humble. Father, I pray now for this week that we would have opportunities to tell people about you. Give these men some good rest tonight, and I pray that we'd be able to be an encouragement to them as they've been to us. We love you, Lord. Thank you for saving us, and we look forward to seeing you. But until then, strengthen us to do the work. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.